What do you mean by that, ma?
இப்ப கேக்குதுமா? Some hard songs are there.
சரி மகன், இருக்குங்க. ஓகே, hope I finish this class properly. Really hate all this nonsense. Sorry, okay. We are getting back to where we are. We are only discussing about the first type of wall, which is called a gravity wall. As the name indicates, the gravitational force, indirectly the load, it is always with the whatever is there. You've already studied about all this. Your mass into your gravitational force, that mg, is the downward acting thing. And this downward acting force and the pressure has to be above all your moment, because the moment is a moving force, which is actually upturning yours. You know, the pivotal force, that upturning force, your moment, and your shear, which is going to act along a 45 degree or at an angle, and your lateral and perpendicular soil pressure. So these perpendicular soil pressures, though we are assuming it like that, there may be shear acting along a wall. The shear is always at 45 degrees. So at 45 degree force, and your force which is going to overturn your retaining wall, the entire thing is designed to overcome all these types of failure mechanisms or failure actions. So just by sheer strength, this is like your, you know, Hercules. By the sheer size and the heaviness of the wall, it is doing its work. The next thing is the pile. So you can see this pile. Pile is nothing but like a sheet. That entire sheet, you have seen corrugated sheets, asbestos sheets, or imagine something like that. Your steel sheet is continuously driven along the entire soil face, and it goes down also very, very deeply. So this entire sheet, excuse me, this entire sheet is called the sheet pile. In other words. So this is again second type, where you have a continuous length on the entire side. Okay. So we are just going to look at how it is going to look. Okay. So this in this is how you draw, and this is the thing. And have you seen this? This retaining wall. See, now the retaining wall is constructed like this, and because of this upward load was acting on this tip, and it turned like this and it broke. So this is a failure picture, and you can see this retaining wall kind of twisted on the opposite side, and this got twisted on the opposite side. This is because the bonding between the two parts are not good, and at the same time the moment, it wasn't able to restrict the moment, and so it shifted. So this picture shows a failure, not the actual retaining wall. This is a failed retaining wall. So again, the third, I think instant I, so the second type is the normal pile. You've seen that. The third type is a cantilever. So you've been listening to this word again and again for quite some time. So if you remember this eccentrically loaded foundations and strap foundations, where one wall is an eccentric loaded and a strap beam is connected to the nearest foundation. This is something like this. This is cantilevered. Because this part, you know, this bottommost leg or toe, this is called the toe of the thing. This toe of the retaining wall is actually cantilevered from the main gravity. See, this part, if you look at this, this part is the main cavity wall, gravity wall. And this part is the toe. This toe gives some extra added effect. You know, what happens is when something is moving, this kinds of anchors. Go back to this. See, instead of it, this top is like this, isn't it? So when I have something like this, I can have as many as pins. In this toe can be on this back and in the front. So whenever there is an up, if the moment is going to act like this and then twist this, this is anchored to this point. This is kind of anchored, this part. So it will not allow the upward moment to act on the wall to shift it like this. It will never be like this, because this entire point is anchored. So it will be stable. Similarly, because of this bit, extra bit, which is anchoring to this part, whatever, I'm going to change the color, this never twist like this again. Because this is going to hold it. So this just drawn over again and again. I hope it's clear. I'm going to draw it, redraw it neatly. So because of this anchor, this movement is arrested. And similarly, because of this anchor, there won't be any. The wall cannot move from this point. Again, this will put on pressure, and so automatically the wall will be in place. So these two extra bits or toes of the cantilever, the toes of the gravity wall, they make this cantilever retaining wall. So the cantilever retaining wall has a toe. That is a difference between your that first one and this third one. So next comes your anchored walls. Okay, anchored walls are done when you have a very good soil. Here it's a very good soil, and this is, in other words, I'm going to type it in the chat box. Please listen. Just have a look at it. This is called soil nailing. You've heard the word nailing, right? Nailing is where you actually use a nail and then hammer it down. So similarly, we are going to nail the entire retaining wall to the soil itself, because the soil is very good, and we are going to use the same soil to tie itself. This is like, you know, imagine sometimes try to touch your shoulder blades with your both the hands on the opposite side. I mean, if you try to shut, this is kind of hugging yourself. So this is the same thing we are trying to do with soil nailing. We are trying to make sure the soil hugs itself with our retaining wall, so that they are in place. They are actually compacted and they are staying in place. So this is the idea of anchoring. What we are going to do is, we are going to actually actually puncture a hole in the soil, and then insert a dowel. So imagine this is my soil, okay, and I have to cut it, and then so that make sure it actually it's in a neat way, because you can't just draw straight away on top of your all these irregularities. You cannot construct your retaining wall. Imagine I have cut, because this slope is also, again, this may be the angle of repose of the soil, but our retaining wall will not stand this very, you know, less than 45 degree angle. So I have to make it, you know, cut the soil so that in which my retaining wall can stand, because my RCC has an angle of repose. So this is the original angle of this is how it was, but I'm going to only work with this part. Okay, so I have just made this. Okay, this black initial black line was the serrated edge or the irregular edge of the hill. Okay, then you just kind of smoothened it out, but this smoothened edge is this angle of this thing, you know, repose of the ground is not the angle of repose of my RCC retaining wall. So I will further fine tune it to suit my retaining wall. So now assume this is going to be my retaining wall face. Okay, I have just smoothened it out, and this retaining wall. In this, what we'll do is, first I will actually insert dowels. Dowels are nothing like, imagine your tubes, okay? One end closed tube, okay? First, dig a hole in the soil surface, and then insert these kind of pipes, you can say pipes, okay? Imagine pipes. Pipes with this edge closed, okay? And these pipes are big like this. And now, this entire thing is a hollow. You are actually following me till now, right? All of you are clear, right? Any questions or any doubts, just put it in the chat box. If you are fine with it, just type yes. One of you at least type yes. So we are going to dig a hole in the earth and then put a dowel. This dowel is called... Guys, am I clear or I'm talking to myself? And if you say yes or no, because I have very low, yeah, fine. Okay, thanks. Thank you so much. So this pipe or the dowel is done, just driven into the soil, driven into the soil. And if you closely look at this dowel, this pipe, it's not a smooth pipe. Instead, what will happen is this pipe look like a normal pipe, but outer edge, I'm not drawing the section, I'm just drawing the elevation now, okay? The outer edge will have serrations like this, like your RCC rod. This is because the more the serration it has, it is going to have a better bonding with the surrounding soil. So it is actually looking like this, like your bitter gourd. You have seen pavaka, something like that. This pipe is like a pavaka, so it has all serrations on top, so it bonds very well with your soil. So we have put this, and then the inside is hollow. Now after driving this one, I'm going to put my steel rod. Okay, I'm just using another. Let me use a blue. So the steel rods are put in, and now I am going to apply tensioning or pre-stressing. So this is very, very important. Okay, I will actually connect this to a machine. Okay, and then this machine will actually pull the rod. Indirectly, it is going to apply as many as kilonewtons of force I have prescribed. If the structural engineer is going to say apply 150 kilonewtons of load, then I'm going to apply 150. If it is going to be 4500 kilonewton, it is going to be 4500 kilonewtons. So you just pull the rod. Okay, I shouldn't be drawing the same color. Very sorry. The rod ends here. Okay, this is the cable through which you are applying the pressure to the system. So this with this your rod ends. Or even not with this, actually. With this, your rod ends. So this is the end point of your rod, where it is coupled with other things, and then it is fixed to the thing. So this is the end of the rod. And now after pulling it, now just remember, after pulling it, now this is under a very high tension, okay? This rod is like your elastic hairband. So it is really, really tight. Now what you do is, take, this is called genetting or concreting or concreting or genetting. Yes. So what you are going to do is bring a to say this. Okay, you will have a small tube. Okay, and imagine this is like your paste. You have seen the toothpaste. Okay, the entire concrete is mixed, and this is through a small tip, needle like tip, your concrete is poured into this dowel, because there is a gap between the dowel and the rod. This has to set in, right? So the thing will actually fill in. And after filling in, you remove the rod. So it goes back and it holds that entire along, because it's at a very high pressure. It just holds this. It nails, indirectly, it nails this entire retaining wall to the soil. So this is called anchoring. You can do it as many as numbers. See, I've just only shown one section. There may be every 3 meters. So this is a section, okay? This is a section. In the elevation, it's going to be a straight wall, isn't it? So the structural engineer is going to tell me, okay, make it every 6 meters center to center throughout the drawing. So I'll make it every 6 meters center to center. And if he's going to tell me, okay, no, just follow my pattern as I've given, I will follow the same pattern as in the structural drawing. So this is the elevation. Any doubts, ma? Are you clear about this? This is the elevation. When you drive along this road, this is what you will see. But you may not see this, because this is a section. This is the elevation. This is your road and this is your car. Okay, when you drive, this is how you will see this. These small parts. Or even these parts will be plastered and will be hidden. So you may not even see it. But when you, if it is during construction, if you drive along this line, you will see these dots. But after finishing all this anchoring of at various points as per the structural drawing, you can plaster and finish the entire wall in place. So you will not differentiate between this anchored points and the retaining wall. Everything will look clean and neat. So one question, how will you know that entire dowel is filled with concrete? How? Because this filling this entire dowel with concrete is very, very important. This is how it is going to, transfer the entire stress of the steel to the soil, and it is going to hold this in place. How to make sure that entire dowel is filled with concrete? For what these holes are created, ma'am? This is how we are anchoring, ma. This is like, imagine this. This is an entire piece, this entire retaining wall is a fabric. Oh, sorry, take it as a paper. This is like this entire retaining wall is a paper, and below is this soil. Okay, now how do you fix this paper? This is like your stapler pen. These anchoring points are your stapler pens. You are just going to staple them so that the entire soil surface is kind of kept in place. It is not loosening or falling out. This is like binding your books. To prevent the inside of the book, you have a bound cover. So something like this, your and this retaining wall is like a cover, which is preventing the soil from loosening and falling off. And you are going to use, instead of stapler pins or bound pins, you are going to use the soil nailing technique. Is this clear? Have I answered? So can you tell me how to make sure this entire concrete is filling this hole, dovel hole? How will you calculate it, or how will you find it? Theoretically or practically, there are two answers. Can you help me?
By compressing, ma'am. By compressing the concrete, ma'am.
But you won't be able to see it, no? Once you finish the work, no one will really know what is going to happen, whether the steel is really decompressing the concrete or whether the load we have actually thought it is going to transfer it to the soil, is it happening or not? Nothing will be known. Because this is a very colorful diagram I'm drawing for you, you are able to differentiate things. But at sight, most of them are very monochromatic and you might not really see this at a very this level. No, already we are using a needle-like structure to fill the dowel. Any more answers? Why no one is interested in answering other than Arun and the usual gang? Explain whatever answer you are giving. You might actually start a new technology also, so you might want to share it with the class. You know, just say it loud so that we'll also understand what you are trying to say by sound. How are you going to use sound to find out whether it is hollow or it is filled with concrete? Money would you by compress the concrete while filling? Now already this connecting this process of filling up the concrete itself is very under compression, because this machine itself is kind of, you know, your toothpaste doesn't come fall like, you know, certain ointments, they don't come just like that, right? When you open the cap, it doesn't fall out of the cap. It's actually kind of, you know, you have to squeeze it, right? So similarly, you're squeezing your concrete into the dowel. Imagine the dowels are about 2 to 2.5 inches dia. That is the maximum size. You know, just make a circle with your forefinger and your thumb. Slightly bigger than that, or yeah, whichever is the longest finger and your thumb. That is the maximum circle size for the majority of the structure. You know, it's going to be 40 mm. That is just 4 centimeters, right? Okay. I'll come back to. I'll give you a simple example. Try to answer from that. If someone is going to ask you, what is the, just fill this cup with water. What will you do? When will you stop? Practically, if your mother is asking you to fill a bucket of water, she's saying, yeah, fill the bucket of water because there is going to be power cut now for the next 4 or 5 hours. So we have to store water. What will you do? Yeah, when it overflows. Yes, the very simple idea is when it overflows, you stop. Or when it is nearly filled. As others have said, it's as when nearly when it is going to overflow or when it is tipped to the brim. So when you are already applying concrete in a very, you know, under pressure, it is going to fill all the nooks and crannies of your dovel. So when it is going to overflow, you just stop. As simple as that. This is what you do it in your in a normal day-to-day thing. So this is idea one. Very practically you are doing. You are just going to fill concrete, and when it is going to overflow, you stop it. But imagine you are a very strict and sincere person, and you wanted to make sure that the entire a hole is filled with concrete. No, this thumb rule and things like that. No practical things. You wanted to make sure the entire concrete and the entire gap between the dowel and the concrete, steel rod is filled with concrete. Any mathematical ideas how to achieve this theoretically or mathematically? How do you do that? Very, very simple.
Ma'am, by pouring concrete from the end to the starting point, ma'am.
Yes, child, that is what you are going to do. Because see, you will not see once the dowel is driven inside the into the mountain. You won't even be able to see what is happening inside. Okay, this I'm going to draw this. Maybe this will give you an idea. Okay, this dowel is a cylindrical dowel. Okay, this is the diameter of the dowel. And assume this is the length I have put in. Okay, assume just 3 meters or whatever. Okay, this is for fun sake we are assuming this. And this is my steel rod. And the remaining area, I have to fill it with concrete. Any mathematical formula? D1 is the diameter of the rod. Kashif, I'm not able to understand what you are saying. Can you rephrase? Guys, have you done the volume of cylinder problems when you are in 8th standard or in 7th standard? Please don't say no. What's the volume of the cylinder? Thanks, ma. Someone is good. Arun Kashif. Very good. So, pi r squared h. Instead of r, now you know d, isn't it? Yes, thank you. Pi r squared is the area of the cylinder and d is the, h is the height of the cylinder. In this case, we know height is 3 meter. Instead of just your d, usual thing, we are going to do it as d minus d. Okay. We'll do this as capital D. Okay. So, capital D is the double dia. So D minus D1. So D minus D1 is the remaining space in the cylinder. So if I calculate the volume of the concrete like this, and I'm getting about just for imagine, for all the for every four dowels, I have to fill about 1 cubic meter of concrete. I'm just exaggerating for calculation purposes only. Assume for every one, I'm getting an answer of 1 cubic meter. Okay, for every 10 piles. Okay. 10 nails or 10 dowels, I have to use 1 cubic meter of concrete. So this is a mathematical answer. So if I've used the concrete without wasting, for every 10 pile, more or less, if I'm going to use 1 cubic meter, sometimes it is going to become 0.99 or 0.98. That's okay. Sometimes it is going to become 1.1. That's also fine. So with allowable tolerance, if the concrete I have mixed is used for nailing, again mathematically or actually we can find out that we have exactly utilized the concrete, so there are no gaps. So this is second step. First thing, you are just filling it, and then when it's overflowing, you are stopping. Second thing is you can actually calculate how much of concrete went into the dowel or into the driven poles for the anchoring, and you can compare it with the mathematical calculations and then check. If both are aligning, then well and good. You have done it very correctly. So, okay. So, this is a drawing of structural drawing. I hope all of you are very... okay, I've actually posted in the Google Classroom also. We are going to have a session in which I will teach you how to read a structural drawing. That is very, very important. And I hope I'll try to make you guys fall in love with building construction and structural drawing. I'll try my best. And see, this is how it is going to look like. And it's nice, colorful, isn't it? All the rods are shown in pinkish red and RCC in slight light yellow. And all these... you know, the circle and the cross, it shows the diameter, the symbol, no? So where a circle is drawn with a diagonal cut, it's the diameter. And so these rods are placed at, these are 12 mm rods are used for this pile, and at 150 mm center to center. This idea is, if the first rod is placed here, the second rod is 150 mm from that, another rod is 150 mm center. So continue to the entire length of the retaining wall. Just assume now you have about 1.5 meters. So how many rods of 12 mm will you would have used? Just guess. And you have a 1.5 meter length of wall. You have to follow every 150 center to center distance. How many things you will have? How many numbers of 12 mm rod will you need? Okay, see, this is the wall. Okay, this is the wall in elevation. The structural engineer has said, okay, you have to put rods, 12 mm rods. This is 150 mm is the center to center distance. My entire wall is 1.5 meter center to center distance. Roughly how many will you have? How many numbers of rods you will require? This is one. This is two. So how many more? Yes, 10. Technically, for example, theoretically it is 10, but normally you will leave some cover because you can't start the rod exactly at that zero point and end at the zero point because it has to be protected by concrete cover on either side. So, but yes, roughly it is 10. But what happens is at site, sometimes you might think it is 1.5 meter. Sometimes there might be a bit of the wall, or at this wall might continue for this entire length of 6.8365 length, no, actually. But the structural engineer may not be able to give you the exact number of rods. So indirectly, they'll always specify the center to center distance. You need not actually calculate whether it's 10 rod or 14 rods. You will just continue this process for the entire available length.